We begin this part of our journey on the island of Patmos, a mere 37 miles from Miletus, a once powerful city on the Turkish coast. The island is best known as the place where St. John the Evangelist wrote the Book of Revelations. Famous for its religious past, it is sometimes called the Jerusalem of the Aegean. A chance to rest. Relax. Looks like just another Greek fisherman. They look more like shoppers. One of the many ferries that visit the islands. John was exiled to Patmos in 95 AD for about 18 months. It is believed that it is here he received the visions of Apocalypse, which became the Book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible. Below here is the cave where John heard the voice of God, who dictated him to write the Apocalypse, containing all those revelatory messages on patience, repentance, salvation, and the protection of nature. We had the opportunity to meet with the patriarch of this monastic order. While we waited, one of the monks, English by birth, answered our questions.
So there is strictly prayer and exercising. We don't do much devotion. Part of the philosophy, the Orthodox philosophy, is not trying to convert people. For example, if you ask me to enlighten you on something or tell you something, I will tell you. But that's not my purpose. Near me, just trying to convert them from Catholics, making them Orthodox, or it's up to him. I don't think.
The monastery and fortress was built in the 11th century by a group of soldier clerics. The monastery has 10 chapels, but the main chapel has a marble floor with rich decoration and frescoes representing the miracles attributed to St. John.
This is an exonarthing, an affix outside the church. In other words, plenty of exonarthing in various parts of this building. And we have quite a few 17th century frescoes in this exonarthing.
The monastery has a museum with an amazing collection of priceless religious relics, rare manuscripts, icons, and vestments embroidered with silver and gold thread and bejeweled with precious stones. From the Callisto, we can see the monastery on the right at the top of the hill, and three windmills no longer in use. Patmos is one of the smallest inhabited islands of the Aegean, with an area of only 22 square miles and a population of 3,000. This is the only commercial port on the island. And that's why we have the customs here. This toy-like truck contains the catch of the day that the restaurant owners will soon be purchasing.
We're in beautiful downtown Patmos, enjoying our last hour here.
Our last hour? That's great.
Did you see the large palm tree behind you? Well, I mean, look at that. It's an unusual.
I can't resist the bougainvillea. The church is not all whitewashed. The city is very quaint, with its whitewashed houses and narrow lanes and flourishing courtyards. Not to mention colorful doors. Is that George?
Patmos. I don't know. Is his first name George?
He's Greek. It probably is.
Giannis?
Or John? Oh, that's right. George or John. Giannis.
We leave Greece and set sail for the port city of Kusadasi in Turkey. A short distance from the port is Ephesus, the site of a succession of great ancient civilizations. On the hill stands a statue of Mustafa Atatürk, the founder of the Turkish Republic and its first president. Ephesus is probably best known for this Temple of Artemis, one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. It was built entirely of marble, with 125 huge columns. This restored niche room has a beautiful statue of Artemis and an image of Socrates in the red fresco. This is a recreation of a private home. This statue, called the Great Artemis, is from the 1st century BC. There is a lion hugging her neck. The goddess of hunting and wildlife, she has bulls, bees, and angels on her skirt. This statue is called the Beautiful Artemis. She has two feline animals accompanying her. Emperor Domiti, 1st century AD. This exquisitely crafted sacrificial altar was in the temple of Domitian. This elegantly carved frieze is believed to have decorated some type of household item. This statue of a warrior was from the Fountain of Pollio. This restoration contains statuary pieces from the Fountain of Trajan. Of the original 125 columns of the Temple of Artemis, this is all that remains. Both Paul and John the Evangelist spent time in Ephesus. St. John died here. This Church of St. John was built by Justinian in the 5th century AD. Beyond the church is the Iasulic Fortress. The citadel was a major mercantile center in the 5th century AD. This was the site of the original Church of St. John. This mosque was erected in 1375 by one of the Seljuks. The materials used in its construction came from Ephesus. One of the minarets still stands. The Church of St. John was in the shape of a cross and covered with 6 domes. The blue and gray veined columns are beautiful. This section shows the 2 stories of columns that would have separated the 3 naves and supported the 6 domes.
Corners where the statues of the 4 gospel writers were. 3 steps, 3 nikkei. God doesn't have a beginning, doesn't have an end. This point right here, this is a submerge. This is a total submerge. That's marble, not original, redone. Some of the nails are still on its original places. So these iron nails hold the marble. And you see the lead around it? Lead is to isolate the iron from air to avoid oxidation.
This is the marble-covered tomb of St. John. Some of the mosaic floors are in good shape, considering their age. We have now moved to the Greek Agora area. It dates to 600 BC. These pipes carried water and other things during the Roman times. This Roman Odeon was built in the 2nd century AD. It would have been enclosed with a wood roof. It held about 1,500 people. Ephesus was originally a seaport on the Aegean. The flat area in the background was once the sea. This excavation is one of the Prytanean temples, or Palace of the Council. The palace was used for organizing city affairs, and it was also the dwelling place of the governmental body of the province. This building also contained the sacred fire, which once burned continuously. The fire symbolized the heart of Ephesus. Just down the road is the Temple of Domitian, a 2-story structure reached by the stairs in the rear. The double arch of brick and stone is where the port was. Looking down Curitis Street, we see the memorial to Memmius decorating the square of Domitian with its huge carvings. At the end of Curitis Street is the Library of Celsus, built in 135 AD, a relief of Hermes, the Greek messenger god. Here is Nike, a goddess who personified triumph. More beautiful sculptured pieces of the puzzle. This 2-story fountain was built in honor of Emperor Trajan in the 1st century AD. The base is all that remains of the statue of Trajan. The Temple of Hadrian was built in 138 AD. Over the inner door is a figure of Medusa. On both sides of the street, there were colonnaded galleries with roofs to protect pedestrians and beautiful mosaic floors. We are standing in an environmentally controlled restoration area of two large homes. These are peristyle Roman houses. All the rooms are ornamented with frescoes and mosaics. This is a marble bath. This house had its own chapel. These houses were three-storied. These are referred to as the houses of the rich. This particular house is over 9,000 square feet. This corner piece is marble. This life-size fresco puzzle gives us an idea of the complexities of restoration. Because of the great size of this chapel, it is believed a high official of the church resided here. Clay pipes beneath the floors and in the walls carried hot air to heat the house.
The frescoes on the wall. Different periods of frescoes on top of each other. As you can see over there. Containers on these urns that you see. The idea of these chippings on the walls, you have to chip the fresco underneath so that you can put the new one. That's the only way that it would hold. Right. That's the third house. That one, 40%. Ephesus Lovers. Who are they? You, us, Ticket, and other sponsors. $7.5 million down that wall. Is the cost of the modern roof and the preservation concept. What they have done, which is an amazing thing, this is lightweight aluminum. It's not that hard to put this. The hardest thing is, first to work in the house. An entire marble, fresco, mosaics was taken up, folded, packed, put somewhere else, and then they can put this thing. Shells up.
The mosaics and frescoes in this house are well preserved. This particular house was over 20,000 square feet. The mosaics are likewise well preserved. This atrium or central court with a pool of water in the middle was surrounded by rooms ornamented with frescoes and mosaics. The atriums were open to the sky and were the only source of light for the house. The main road in Ephesus is called the Marble Street. It was built in the 1st century AD. The Celsus Library is one of the most beautiful structures in Ephesus. The library was built with double walls, meant as soundproofing and also to protect the manuscripts from humidity. The facade has four statues symbolizing wisdom, knowledge, intelligence, and virtue. The former governor Celsus is also entombed here. Between the library and the Roman Agora is a colossal portal with an inscription dedicating it to Caesar Augustus. The world's first advertisement is for a brothel.
Here, left foot, heart, woman with a tiara. Beautiful as a queen. The inscription's gone.
The harbor road leads from the port to this vast stadium, which seats 24,000 people. This theater was also the site of one of the early conflicts between Christianity and idolatry, that is, the followers of Christ and Artemis. Paul was imprisoned as a result, and later banished from Ephesus. these ruts were made by chariots. This symbol is supposed to be significant, but I forgot why or how. That afternoon, there was even time for shopping. Carpets, jewelry, and other Turkish delights were plentiful. The Callisto certainly seemed small compared to this large cruise ship. Someone said it looked like a bath toy. That evening, we gather in the bar while the Congers renew their marriage vows.
Thank you.
I thought she would.
The groom is still sitting down. The groom is still sitting down.
Yeah.
Are you not going to get up?
Hold up.
She's the flower girl. Go ahead. That's your turn, Betsy. Betsy, time to go.
By the powers vested in me, I now pronounce you man and wife. With God hath joined together, let no man put us under.
Amen.
You may now kiss the bride.
That's how you stay. That's why
we depart Kusadasi and follow the Turkish coast north to Daikali for an excursion to Pergamum. The pier is busy this morning. Pergamum was first settled in the 8th century BC, but it rose to prominence in the Hellenistic period and became the eminent center of culture for nearly 150 years. The chopped-off colonnade on the right led to the Temple of Athena. The sanctuary has one lone olive tree. The Zeus altar, currently in Berlin, was located here and was considered by many as the finest altar ever built. This theater seats 10,000 people and is said to have the steepest rake of all Hellenistic theaters. This area is the underlayer of the Temple of Trajan. The arched and vaulted stoa supported the terrace in front of the temple. In the 2nd century AD, Hadrian built the temple to his predecessor, Trajan. In the background, below the Acropolis, is the city of Pergamum. Our group seems a bit spread out. Below the temple was the famous library built by Eumenes II and believed to house some 17,000 volumes. When the Egyptians prohibited the export of papyrus, the Greeks at Pergamum discovered that parchment was a better alternative. This was the propylaea, or the entrance to the Temple of Trajan. Hadrian used the Corinthian order. Here we see the restoration of the temple. The aqueduct was built during Roman times and actually came all the way up to the top of the Acropolis. Who could forget sailing through that horrendous storm to reach Kavala? Above the harbor, on the site of the ancient Acropolis, is a Byzantine castle, originally called Neapolis. It was a significant commercial hub during Paul's time, around 50 AD. The many-dome building is the Imaret. It was built by Mehmet Ali Pasha in the early 19th century. Today, it is a luxury hotel. Kavala is a vivid city with a pleasant climate and modern facilities. A short ride from Kavala is Philippi, a most important archaeological site. The high walls around the Acropolis also surrounded the foot of the hill and part of the valley below. The inner wall, built in the 4th century BC, appears to be supported by flying buttresses. The outer wall is 6th century AD. The theater dates to Philip II, about the 4th century BC. Philip, incidentally, was the father of Alexander the Great. The theater was modified during Roman times to protect the audience during the battles with beasts. A 6-foot-high marble wall around the perimeter would have protected the audience. This reconstructed entrance still contains reliefs from Greek and Roman times. Nike, the Greek goddess of triumph. This is the site of Basilica A. This three-aisle basilica is the largest ever excavated. It was destroyed by an earthquake in 600 AD and never rebuilt. The walls were two-story, with columns supporting decorated arches. The large base of what must have been an imposing ambo fronts the huge altar. Only these two original columns still exist. There are even some rich frescoes.
This is a good section of the frescoes that survived. What is interesting, even though the colors, and of course, since it is exposed, it's getting worse every year, like that. Anyway, you see colors, the red mm-hmm. and the rest. Most of the actual fresco has been washed down. You can see the plaster row. Yeah. And this is clearly imitating marble revetment. all these colors and the patterns. Even though it's not marble, they are imitating marble. And if you approach and you look carefully, you will see that you have the imprint of a tiny string with which they would create the straight lines. They would be using strings, push them in the wet plaster, and then paint and divide accordingly the whole surface with this. It's quite interesting, and further up there are some of the colors surviving.
It is amazing how much of the baptistry has survived. We are waiting to get a look at the prison of St. Paul. The structure is actually a Roman water cistern, but now it has developed into kind of a cult place. These rock piles are from the narthex. People would have waited here before entering the main church. Looking down on the forum, or the administrative center in the Roman period, we see Basilica B in the background. At this end of the forum stood the Corinthian Genius Temple. On that same side was the library, where an entryway is still visible. At this end of the south side portico was a public forum. On the west side were the governmental buildings. The Via Ignacio was the Roman road running through the center of Philippi. The road stretched for 538 miles between the Adriatic and Black Seas. This is the route Paul traveled on his way to Rome. I forgot what this is. Maybe it's just ancient graffiti. I'm not sure about this one either. The great walls that surrounded the city and part of the valley began at the top of the hill. The three-aisled Basilica B dates to the 6th century AD. The basilica was modeled after the Hagia Sophia in Istanbul. These giant pillars were designed to support a large dome. Unfortunately, the dome collapsed before the interior was finished, and it was never replaced. Excellent samples of ornamental art are the capitals and their pilasters. The marble almost looks like lace. With the foliage are these intricately carved fish. This is the baptistry of Basilica B. Behind the forum was the palaestra, or gymnasium. The only part excavated, however, was the men's room.
So there was water rushing down underneath, under the seats, taking everything away, washing it away. And in front, you can see, in front of the seats, there is a small channel. There would be clean water there for people to use with sponges in order to clean themselves.
The channel for the water, clean.
This is the area of the octagonal church that was built around 400 AD. Actually, the church was square, but it had an octagonal interior. The cover is to protect the mosaic floors. It is believed that the octagonal church replaced the first small church dedicated to the Apostle Paul. We do know that because of Paul, Philippi is the site of the first Christian community in Europe, and that Lydia was the first Christian baptism in Europe. This church/baptistry is a monument to her memory. The church, built in 1974, is an example of early Christian austerity. It has an open sanctuary with a simple font in the middle to remind us of Lydia's significance. Lydia was thought to be a soulmate of Paul's, since they were both from Asia Minor. Lydia was thought to be wealthy, and Paul lived in her house while he stayed in Philippi. Even the iconostasis is open in this church. This probably represents Paul establishing the church in Europe. Saint Barbara may have been included here because, like Paul and Lydia, she was from Asia Minor. I included her because she has the same name as my roommate. These colorful stained glass windows are of Lydia and Paul with hair. This monument marks the spot along the Zygactus River where Paul baptized Lydia.
The city had the first communist mayor back in 1934 in Greece. He didn't last long. 2 years later, we had a dictatorship in Greece. People just who are just enjoying both their coffee, beans, whatever, and each other's company more than anything else. On this beautiful day, on Sundays, this is quite common, but exactly because you have elections, you have many people visiting from other parts, getting together.
We are on our way to lunch at Mehmet Ali's house. This Orthodox church was once a mosque, as one can probably tell from the domes and minaret. More tourists. This cobblestone street is lined with cafes. This equestrian statue is of Mehmet Ali Pasha, who was born in Kavala in 1769. He became the Viceroy of Egypt and is considered the founder of modern Egypt. His home is now a great restaurant.
You want it?
You share with him?
No.
You can salad with. What
would you like to drink now?
And I miss the wine.
Fish.
We stop for a short tour of the Imaret Hotel. This is one of several inner courtyards. Built by Mehmet Ali, the Imaret dates back to 1818. The personal mosque of Mehmet Ali, with this prayer niche or mihrab, have been preserved. The ceiling even has a touch of the Baroque. Calligraphy and quotes from the Quran are typical mosque decoration. This balcony would have been Mehmet Ali's worship area. The hotel has numerous areas designed for individual enjoyment and relaxation. The views were great too. Now it is time to get back on the bus for the short trip to Thessaloniki. Thessaloniki has a rich history. It was founded in 315 BC and named after Alexander the Great's sister. It was to become the chief city of Macedonia and its most important commercial port. During Byzantine times, it was a cultural and artistic center, second only to Constantinople. Across this bay is Mount Olympus. Unfortunately, the fog will not lift on this trip. A brief look at the Galerius Arch and the rotunda in the background. The Hagia Sophia was constructed in the 8th century AD, and it was modeled after the Hagia Sophia in Istanbul. While the original building was a dome basilica with its aisles, the interior now has a cruciform design. The iconostasis is richly done. A great deal of time, effort, and money has gone into the restoration of the artistic pieces. The artwork in the dome is actually a mosaic. The mosaics in the dome and sanctuary are dated to the 8th to 12th century AD. Samaro is speaking of the several fires that damaged the church. The pulpit is intricately carved. This minaret was added when the Turks first occupied Thessaloniki in the 15th century and converted all the churches to mosques. We have driven up the hill from the coast to the quaint old Turkish quarter. This tower was part of the wall fortifications built around the city during Byzantine times. We are looking at the east wall that eventually goes down to the coast. It is interesting to note that the individual guard posts along the wall were spaced 2 arrow shots apart. That way, the entire fence was covered by fire. The round building built of bricks is the rotunda, built in the early 4th century AD. The round brick tower by the sea is the famous or infamous White Tower. In the center of town, they have uncovered a small part of the ancient Roman Forum. Built in the 2nd century AD, it has stoas on 3 sides. On the east side, there is an odeon for public performances with shops on either side. This monument is a 5-aisled basilica dedicated to Saint Demetrius, the patron saint of Thessaloniki. The church has a storied past. The five-aisle basilica was first erected in the 7th century AD. It was converted to a mosque in the 15th century and restored in 1912. Unfortunately, it was destroyed by fire in 1917 and closed for excavation until 1949, when it started to function again as a church. The narthex was exquisitely decorated. The fine detail work is evident in these Corinthian capitals. The beauty of the nave, with its ancient Greek styling, is only surpassed by the unbelievable mosaics in the sanctuary. Something you would never guess except by close inspection. Here is a small altar to Saint Demetrius.
Now, what you're looking at is one of the earliest decorations of this church, which seems to be going back to the very original building. We're dealing with something that probably dates back to the somewhere between the 5th and the 6th century AD, in other words, that mosaic. And of course, the mosaic itself, it's extraordinary. We have all these tiny tessera, these pieces. For the golden background of this halo, you actually have glass paste with gold foil in it, whereas his hands and also the rest of the garment is not gold, it's silver. Silver in glass base, that's why it is a bit grayish and darker, because over the years it has obviously turned a bit darker. And in this mosaic here, and another one that is on the other aisle, but I won't really take you there, look for it in the corresponding.
This is another of the 5th and 6th century mosaics that was mostly destroyed by the fire of 1917. This is the side chapel and casket of Saint Demetrius. Saint Demetrius is the patron saint of Thessaloniki, and along with Saint George, they were the patron saints of the Crusades. They are similarly portrayed in art. Both are mounted warriors, but Saint Demetrius is on a red horse slaying a soldier, while Saint George is on a white horse slaying a dragon. After an hour's ride from Thessaloniki, we arrive in Virginia. After a heavy lunch and light conversation, we will visit the royal tombs of the Macedonian kings, and Agai, the ancient capital of Macedonia. The hill was constructed to protect the tombs from looters. An underground building was constructed in 1993 to protect and preserve the tombs. There are hundreds of these tumuli, or burial mounds, in the area, some dating from the Iron Age, around the 11th century BC. This tumulus contains the royal tombs of King Philip II and a young prince identified as Alexander IV. Underground is the tomb of Alex IV, along with the collapsed Hiroun, a building intended for the cult of dead kings. Most notable were the showcases with the priceless and beautiful artifacts. Near the tombs was the massive palace built by Philip II in the 3rd century BC. This area would have been the interior central court with its Doric columns. This gravel covering is protecting a beautiful mosaic. Unfortunately, my camera doesn't do x-rays. I probably could have done the narration for this video in 1/10 the time if I had had Nancy's notes. Philip II also built this theater. He was assassinated here in 336 BC. Yet another of the proverbial olive trees. Our last night together. Our trip may be over, but experiencing great civilizations of the past and enjoying the adventure with new friends will forever be cherished.